There are three big pieces of a gymnast's development: the gymnast's psychology, the parent's support, and the coach's direction. When all three work in harmony, a champion is produced. When a parent is too invested in their child's need to succeed, this harmony is never met. Parents spend thousands of dollars on coaching and private lessons, which causes burdens on the family. Parents who gossip about other children to move up in the rankings. Parents who refuse to believe a coach's abuse because it can ruin a child's career. Or parents who don't know what abuse is, that they ignore a child when they complain of said abuse. Some parents even defend these coaches even when they are under investigation by national organizations for said abuse. One blaming the abuse on absentee parents and attention seekers. Some of these parents slowly fall into this trance that because in their eyes, their kid is the best. When they are the best, you do everything you can to live their shiny moment. Sacrificing time from work? No problem. Taking out a second mortgage on the house? No problem. Delaying family vacations so that the daughter can attend a local meet? It's worth the wait. Maxing out credit cards for a new competition leotard? Well, if the kid needs it, then it's worth the investment. These parents act out for many reasons. It could be because the parents couldn't afford the gym expenses when they were younger. Unable to do child sports, they begin to live through their kids. And when their kids do well, it's like candy, and you can't stop yourself from getting a taste. On the other hand, parents who slowly fall into this trance start off as loving parents. They place their kid into sports to build confidence, improve social skills, and burn off energy that their parent doesn't have time to do. They start in Mommy and Me classes, and they fall in love with the leotard sequins. The child makes friends in the gym, and you think, well, a couple extra hundred is affordable per year. And the trance builds and builds, and when the family struggles financially, and scholarships and other sponsors are on the line, you can't just pull your kid out. When do these parents go downhill? Well, normally it's a gradual decline. It isn't just a downward spiral, though sometimes it sounds like it. Rita Weber wrote a book to help encourage parents to join gymnastics while providing a safe toolkit for their children. In this section, I will be referencing pieces of her book to help explain some of these problems that parents face. Rita's daughter, Jordan, not only went on to Olympic and collegiate level competing and coaching, but also developed a strong relationship with her mother through the whole process. Something that unfortunately isn't as common as one would think. In elite level sports, it's hard to balance family and a gymnastic career when they both require the same amount of commitment. And lacking commitment leads to broken relationships, divorce, or even lawsuits. A parent is responsible for providing a safe environment where a child can flourish under the coach's care. Many times, parents witness the victory a child faces when given their first award. It may just be a participation certificate or a third place medal for beam. But the parents love it, and slowly but surely, some tend to get swept in the moment for their child's success. And when things are on the line, specifically placement at camps, scholarships, or competition opportunities, it's hard to not get more involved as a parent. But oftentimes, guardians take this moment of success too far and begin to neglect what the kid wants and more of what they need sports-wise. This could mean that the parent neglects the well-being of the child so long as it gets them ahead. Terry Phillips, mother of Christy Phillips, 1988 Olympic alternate, made her daughter's career her life, even going as to having a picture of Christy painted on the side of her van to promote advertising for her daughter's career. Now, this is one dramatic example. Typically, parents don't go this far of a commitment for a child, but many do regret this behavior. Changing their mindset to fit their child's sports career, they slowly lose themselves in the process. Now, looking back at Jalissa Gomez, 1986 to 1988 national team member, and what she went through, I know all she heard took its toll. But as a parent, you become so involved in it, you really just don't see the whole picture. You're really only seeing what you want to see. Jalissa's mother. said Jillis's mother, former gymnast. And this is true. A parent begins to ignore the child's complaints and what they want, focusing solely on what the child needs to do to stay at the top. More hours in the gym, more private ballet classes, and more conditioning are just a few examples. Even if the child doesn't want to do what the parent requests, it no longer becomes a discussion. The child is neglected. One Parkett's parent recalls yelling at a gymnast who had transformed from a happy, successful, standout gymnast to one riddled with self-doubt. "Why don't you appreciate where you are and what you've been given?" This parent now regrets screaming at their daughter, not knowing at the time how horrible it was to them. Parents should recognize the signs of when they are getting caught in the moment and remember that this is the child's sport and not their own. And although a child may go through times where they need additional push, the parent must always communicate with them and the coach for another viewpoint. Many children are neglected in this sport, and it leads to burnout. And sometimes, it's all because the parents refuse to listen to the child. And this is the same with injuries and a child's emotions. Injuries are bound to happen in any sport. And it's something that, although preventable in some cases, a parent's heart drops to see their child in pain. That's how it normally starts, but over time, the parents side with the coach. The coach tells the child that they aren't injured, so that the child continues to practice. Reluctant at first, the parent eventually complies. In the early 2000s documentary on Parkett's, Ashley Berry's parents encouraged their daughter to compete even though she had a broken ankle. She was only 7 and ended up breaking the other ankle months later. Her parents ignored injuries by forcing her on the TOPS placement test while in a cast. The video shows her in pain, icing her ankle as they drive to the distance. Another thing that's neglected is a child's health when they are sick. And it's this simple. If a child is sick, it's less time in the gym. It's less time to train, and it could result in losing skills. Just like an injury, parents try to avoid any chance of limiting their time in the gym, no matter if they are healthy or not. 1988 Olympian Shelley Stack's mother admits to her mistakes over the years. Her mother, Carol, states she threatened refusal to give medication for pain and flu prevention when her daughter did not want to go to the gym. Carol has also admitted to one of her worst mistakes, where she used makeup to help cover up a teammate's chickenpox so that she could compete at a meet. And it leads to problems too. Not treating injuries only worsens a gymnast's career, and if severe, could lead to paralysis or, in very rare cases, premature death. And neglecting sickness weakens the immune system. This means that injuries may take longer to recover from. It lowers their energy levels, making it harder to vault onto the horse or compete a tumbling pass. In the end, the parent doesn't benefit from neglecting a child's health because it damages the child in practice. The thing that's just as bad as ignoring health is ignoring a child when they ask for help or voice their opinion. If a child is complaining of abuse or wanting to leave the gym, a parent must evaluate the situation. If the child is young, around the ages of 2 to 8, a complaint must be taken with a grain of salt. But when a gymnast gets older and is more independent, able to speak for themselves more than before, a parent should take this as a concern. Parkett parents say they have strained relationships with daughters for not listening to their concerns and requests to leave the gym. That neglect leads children resorting to suicide ideation and more. Some parents don't learn, though. Terry Phillips, as of the 1990s, reflects on no regrets with Christie's gymnastic career, while leaving Christie puzzled with her relationship to Bella. Though a broken gymnast mentally, Terry kept her mouth shut and witnessed Christie being abused daily. In the 80s, she was the one who suffered the worst of his abuse, Christie leaving the sport barely in one piece. She also attempted suicide. Parents should focus less on ignoring a child's emotions and injuries because this doesn't improve their career. If a parent listens to a child, it not only creates a bond between the two, but can improve their performance. Simone Biles, 2016 and 2020 Olympians' parents, biological grandparents, have witnessed Simone's ups and downs throughout the process. In 2021, days before the 2020 Olympics, Simone Biles broke down in tears. She called Nellie, her legal mother, and discussed emotional trauma faced while under USAG. Though this trauma was almost 4 years ago, it still affects her daily. I just remember breaking down and calling my mom. She told me to pull over, referring to stop driving, because Biles was crying so hard. She was just hysterical. She didn't say anything. We just cried together, because I knew Simone wanted to talk about it. She would be very angry when I would ask her anything, so I just gave her space until she was ready to talk about it. To this day, Nellie, among many others, is reflected on as putting their child first before the sport. They listen to their child and remove them from a toxic situation. And like Nellie, who listened to her child, Simone's career continued for over two Olympics. Arguably the best gymnast of all time, her 32 Olympic and world medals would not be possible without the support of her legal guardians. Some parents enter children into sports because they vision pretty leotards and cute hair ties. They watch the Summer Olympics and see gymnasts fly on the uneven bars. They jump beautifully on the balance beam, tightly placing one leg by the other in elegant skills. And they want this. They want that grace, and they are determined to get it, no matter what. Parents tend to forget that the reason they should allow children gymnastics is for their well-being and not for themselves. It becomes a hobby for both the child and parent, but slowly an unhealthy addiction. Rita Weber, mother of 2012 Olympian Jordan Weber, admits gymnastics was also an addiction for her. In reality, this was more my addiction than hers. I, more than Jordan, craved the excitement I felt whenever I found a new gymnastic-labeled product. And what's wrong with this? Well, parents should be involved in their child's life, but it should always be about the child's needs and not the parents'. Parents and little girls in pretty boxes say it's the greatest high you can find. It's an amazing feeling when they win. It's your prized possession. When they do well, it's easier for a parent's need of recognition to fulfill the unfilled dream. You push more, yourself and your kids, and you spend money you don't have. We all become junkies for our kids' success. Sometimes, parents get too involved that gymnastics becomes their life, that they begin to lose balance of their own outside of the gym. Shannon Miller, 1992 and 1996 Olympian. Parents were interviewed in a 1993 article. On a fluff piece, it discusses Miller's life. Her father, Ron, who worked at the University of Central Oklahoma, regularly uses his daughter's gymnastics as an example in his teachings. He loves to use a video of Shannon missing the bar when performing a reverse hex. The students are forced to calculate the force with which she hits the ground on the release. When they are finished, he states, "The students often ask, 'Is your daughter still alive?' I then reply yes, and resort to showing her catch the release." Miller's mother, Claudia, states, "I think Ron is stressed and doesn't know it regarding Miller's fame and success from the 92 Olympics. Shannon once told her mom, 'Get Dad under control.'" Parents become stressed, so much so that they feel that they are the ones running the show. Maybe because of all the phone interviews that they oversee setting up. Maybe because they are the ones financially supporting the dream. The ones driving the child to practice. The ones attending the doctor visits and the competitions. They start to live off their child, because to them, they almost are the child. Some parents admit to their mistakes, though, like Carol Stack, who admits that when she was frustrated with her daughter, one day saying, "You didn't make the Olympic team, I did. I would never do it again," said Lauren Irvin, mother of a former Karoli gymnast. "When my daughter said she never let her own daughter do gymnastics, I felt like a failure. All we wanted as parents was the perfect life for her."
"You're trying to make children perfect, and children aren't perfect," said Nancy, whose daughter, Lisa, competed and briefly lived with the Browns. "Some can do it. There are others who just break and destroy, though." Living through your child may draw someone closer to their child's goal, but it's not the way to do it. It puts strains on relationships that can last years to recover from. Jennifer Say had a rocky relationship with both of hers throughout the career she had. When trying to retire, her mother threatened her.
"I won't let you eat if you retire. I'll lock the cabinets. You're not going to throw this away after all the time and money we've spent."
When a parent lives through a child, it is typically out of jealousy. They want to be the child, and it takes their place. Maybe the parent couldn't afford the sport when they were younger, or their career wasn't where it wanted it to be. But when parents live through their child, it puts a damper in their career. If parents are that jealous, they can always enroll themselves in adult gymnastic classes. Not always offered in every gym, but it is slowly becoming more popular. Parents can compete in adult competitions that are both national and local. If a parent is this invested in their child's lives, maybe doing adult gymnastics will get them more involved in their own. Rita Weber states, "As hard as it may be for these parents, if they are acting this way, then it may be better to spend less time at the gym." Rita spent her time trying not to get involved, including not providing tips or feedback to Jordan, relying on her coach only to do this. Rita Weber states that the parents' behavior manifests itself from a desire for control and trust. Those parents have either lost sense of control or trust during the gymnast's career, or may have that in their personality before even joining the gym. Those parents become the mom managers of the gym. Those parents use hand gestures and mouth instructions to their gymnasts from the viewing room. They try to micromanage their gymnasts by telling them to point their feet or pester the coach. In their mind, they feel they are doing nothing wrong, because in their eyes, they feel the feedback and guidance is working for their daughter. But it couldn't be far from the truth. An example of this is using time at home to enforce workouts. Sometimes it's to punish a child, and other times it's to improve the flexibility or add additional conditioning that they missed that day. But parents using time at home to enforce workouts is bad. Amy Jackson's father once bought her a parallel bar and forced her to practice handstand pirouettes while her arms were shaky. "He just got caught up in all of it," his wife stated. Forcing a child to work out at home can be dangerous because the parent isn't trained to know safety and proper form. A child should not be forced to work out at home unless it's instructed by a coach in moderation. But everyone goes through it, and they don't realize it. Rita fell into the toxic parent herself. "I felt like a hypocrite. One minute, I would tell my husband stories of overly competitive moms that I observed, and the next, I'd throw a huge incentive in an effort to impact Jordan's outcome." With parents micromanaging to get to the top, they may also play the political route so that they can stay on top. Terry Phillips was the queen of this when her daughter trained at the Corollis. People stated in little girls in pretty boxes that she had a special seat. God help parents who didn't know that that was her seat in the parents' viewing room. One parent stated she would gossip about parents' daughters and use politics to her advantage. If someone had an eating disorder or was being abused by a parent, she would tell the parents. Once, when an affair was going on with Coach Rick Newman, she told numerous parents. There were no boundaries with Terry. She would make deals with parents by renting a house in Houston, allowing gymnasts and parents to stay at a reduced cost to offset finances. She always found a way to show that her daughter was number one in the gym, even allowing her daughter better treatment and putting her first at home, allowing her longer shower time than the others that were living there. "She ruled the roost at the Corollis," one parent said. "Terry was very likable, but she'd cut your throat behind your back." Parents were forced at the Corollis to help with driving visiting coaches to the airport and volunteering at the gym. If you didn't help, the coach may loathe your child. Parkett's parents from a 2022 interview stated that coaches retaliated against parents who didn't attend a fundraising auction at the gym by kicking their daughter out of practice an hour after they had been dropped off, forcing some to return just as they arrived back home. If parents helped, they would be on good standing. If parents willingly volunteered, they'd be on great standing. And great standing gives the gymnast more exposure, more limelight, more opportunities. and if you support the coaches and USAG, your child will continue to grow. When Olivia Greaves' coach was under investigation, Mary Jo Greaves felt her moral duty was to defend the coach. Mary Jo Greaves posted a very inappropriate post stating that the coach's safe sport trial was because of attention seekers and absentee parents. In this mindset, the parent is more focused on the child's sports reputation than of their own well-being. And the parents will do anything the coach or organization asks for if it means that their kid will get to the top. They play politics, but not all of them do. Jessica McCusker, mother of 2020 Olympic hopeful Riley McCusker, complained to USAG officials of Riley's poor treatment of her coach, like screaming at meets. These comments were so bad that a British official voiced his concerns to a USAG official. In less than a year's notice to find another gym, Jessica complained to higher-ups, including Mark Busby, about her poor treatment. This would risk her chance of making the Olympic team, since it would not only put her daughter on poor standings with the organization, but provide a short amount of time to find a new gym. Jessica did the right thing by putting her gymnast health first before the sport and ignoring repercussions. Alongside parents micromanaging and playing politics, they also stress over finances. Some parents describe competitive gymnastics as a nightmare. It can sever a family and drain it financially. Terry Phillips is a prime example of this. She once said in Little Girls in Pretty Boxes, "Why should I pay $180,000 to have my kid mentally and physically abused?" But she never said it to Bella, who instead would follow his every order and take her frustrations out only on her daughter. One of the worst tragedies came in the late 1990s from Olympian Dominic Mociano. 3 years after the 96 Olympics, she was settled in court over financial custody of her earnings. Her father, Dimitru, who had routinely abused her physically, according to those at Caroli's gym who stated she had been routinely slapped for failing to maintain weight, and emotionally abused, decided to open a new gym under her name. To help with finances, this new gym backfired, costing them a pretty penny. It was a small enrollment at the gym, and he wasn't handling the costs well. Once, Mociano found out how much his father invested. And how little of her earnings were remaining, she sued her parents. One 1990s article stated that she simply divorced them. Many parents struggle with finances, and they don't know how to handle it. They take their frustration out on their children. They make financial decisions that they don't plan out or research. They max their credit cards, and they take out a second mortgage. Rita Weber struggled with finances when Jordan's gym fees tripled in 1 month when she increased onto higher levels. There are some strategies to help pay for some expenses. It's common for parents to work in the gym as a part-time employee to receive benefits or discounts on some attire. Rita Weber stated that for those struggling with finances, there are many ways to get help. For leotards that can cost hundreds, their gym would host an annual Leo sale, where gymnasts who outgrew their Leos would donate them to the gym. Typically, their used Leos would sell $5 to $15 apiece. Parents would save money buying training leotards by investing that money in a competitive leotards instead. Gyms also host booster clubs and fundraisers. Like Gage, their annual Secret Santa Invitational not only gives toys to local charity, but also uses ticket fees into funds for their gym. Some organizations also offer scholarships to offset the cost for a gymnast's gym fees. This is another reason why many gymnasts go pro, because sponsors not only give a large compensation if they win, but their initial down payment goes a long way in the training process. Although many elites won't go pro, many college scholarships help pay for the large sum of tuition. And because it's hard to save for college for the average child, just imagine how hard it is when someone's barely getting by. But as of 2019, college athletes are now able to provide off their college career. The NIL gives the ability for college athletes to make money off of their name, image, and likeness. It's a big rabbit hole that a lot of NCAA schools and organizations are still working on.
Some football and baseball players make millions when they sign with sponsors like Nike and Adidas. It may be the new future of helping offset some costs that a family may face during the gymnast career. It may reduce on parents taking on additional loans, jobs, or payment plans because it's less likely needed to save money for college. I can't say that parents' abuse and stress will be less likely because of NILs, but it could make things easier for their future careers. The parent-coach relationship is rather complex in the elite level. It starts off with small interactions, but slowly becomes more of a challenge if the parents don't see eye to eye. And that's the first mistake they make. Many parents don't realize the toxic gym culture until it's too late. And even if there isn't a toxic gym culture overall, the coach may still be toxic. This can happen at any gym, and the parent must know what to look out for. There are many traits that may make a bad gym, but many people don't see them because of closed practices. As gymnasts climb up levels, some clubs are more likely to provide closed practices and don't allow moms and dads at practice. For safety reasons, parents, as well as non-participating siblings, are not allowed to view their child's practice on a daily basis. The Azarian 2019-2020 handbook states, Azarian is one of many gyms that doesn't allow open practices, limiting parents to see what's going on. I now see the unhealthy black hole loop that we're in at Azarian, a parent wrote in an email to Amy Rogers, a USA Gymnastics investigator. Children are too young to speak up to their parents, too scared to admit that they are being abused when their coach threatens to punish them. Parents are the only ones who can stop it. But how can they if the child is too young to speak for themselves? The other problem is that even if the parent has open practice, sometimes they don't pay attention and realize that the gym is toxic. The gymnast may be emotionally and physically abused, but if the parent doesn't know what's happening, then they can't stop it. And when they find out, it's too late because the damage has been done. One mother left Parkettes when a gymnast was forced to work through a severe stress fracture. The coach, Netwell, yelled at the mother when she requested her daughter to rest and not train at practice per her doctor's orders. This was a doctor not affiliated with Parkettes. The mother later pulled her daughter out of Parkettes. Parents need to be educated on what a healthy gym looks like, and the first part is physically being able to view it. And when they have viewing areas, focus on your kids, how they interact with their coaches, what their energy levels are, and how the coaches are acting around them. What is the atmosphere? If you or the child does not feel safe, they need out of the gym. They don't need to leave the sport, but they need to leave the gym. Over 5 parents from the 2013 to 2016 time at Parkettes spoke with a local news station in 2022 about the regrets that they had faced on the past decade, one saying she wished she listened to her first instinct and not taken her daughter there. But even when they realize that the coach is toxic, the parents are led to believe that this is the only way a gymnast will thrive. But let's be very clear here. You do not need to be in a toxic environment to win. Parents felt compelled on what to do at Parkettes. One parent stated, "My daughter did not want to leave." She did, but she didn't. There were no places nearby where she would get that level of training, referring to her love of the sport, but hatred of working out at Parkettes, knowing she would have less chances of getting into college since most gymnasts were homeschooled and felt their social network existed within the walls of the gym, and that only this gym would get them a college scholarship in the area. You do not need to stay at a toxic gym to get a scholarship. And while it may be a limited number of options, there is always a way to get out of it. And coaches like Liang Chow and Andy Memel are some examples because their gymnasts have gotten scholarships without the abuse. As parents, we don't even realize how bad it is because of the whole "don't tell your parents" and "oh, this is just tough coaching," says one Texas mom who requested to be anonymous in the recent interview. If you want to be the best, this is what tough coaches do. This couldn't be farther from the truth, though. Parents must understand what a toxic gym environment is. They must be aware of what's going on in the gym and if their child is safe. And if there is a problem, they must report it, even if it means losing good status in gymnastics.
Sam Cirio's mother, Becky, reported abuse to Safe Sport when her daughter, Sam Cirio, was hit on the head so hard that it left a hand mark from her coach, Chai Han. Though scared that he would find out he was reported by her, her mother did the right thing by trying to protect her daughter, even if it meant risking a future scholarship. Gymnasts begin at such a young age. Their childhood reflects solely on competitions, autographs, interviews, public appearances, and status. They are also treated like celebrities at just 13 years old. Shannon Miller's family knows it all too well. The family used to get calls from radio stations, television stations, and promoters of parades and beyond. Fans called to know where Miller was so that they could sign autographs. Our phone starts ringing at 6 and doesn't stop until 11 p.m. After a while, you say, "Leave me alone!" Children are being asked to represent themselves before they even know who they are as a person. As parents, people tend to forget just how responsible a child really is. Parents think that children can make safe decisions and think for themselves. Parents believe that, because of the maturity in the sport, that this maturity carries into their personnel. But the sad reality is that children cannot make decisions for themselves. Psychiatrist Toffler said that parents are abdicating their responsibilities when they let young girls make decisions that have potential long-term ramifications. Would you let your 12 or 13-year-old have sex just because they want to? Toffler said. It's the same argument when you let them make decisions, like overtraining. Children will not stick up for themselves if a coach yells or puts their life at stake when training for a skill. Children are not protected from the abusive coach, and parents may not always know this. Athletes are often discouraged from talking about what goes on in the gym at home, which normally doesn't lead their parents to question the coaches. Because you're giving your children all your support, you don't think people can come and destroy all that, said Otilia Gomez. Parents should always register that children are children and not adults. Although they are competing at a sport that is meant for an adult's maturity to handle, kids aren't ready for the pressure that the sport faces. Parents should be constantly monitoring children. Their relationship with the coach, the publicity that it brings, and the mental health and psychology of the child. The child is simply a child. The parent needs to protect them. They cannot protect themselves without the parents' help. Parents seem to get so caught up in the sport that they forget the whole point of the sport, which is to build character for their future. Gymnastics provides dedication, obedience, work ethic, group thinking, and many other leadership traits. But parents tend to restrict their children for preparing for their future and only preparing for the short-term sport. For instance, Lindsay Van Eckel's parents became frustrated when Lindsay couldn't attend 40 hours a week practice at WOCA. They created Start Right Academy, an online school that shortened school hours so they could have more workout time. This removed her from public school, though, and severely limited her social life and hours spent in education. Her parents felt the sport was more important than developing her daughter's career. There are good parents who have learned from mistakes and shielded their daughters, like Hillary Henderson, whose mother, Kathy, limited training to 20 hours a week, allowed holiday breaks, didn't limit food intake, encouraged college and staying in public school. Parents like Kathy put their daughter before their career. One father from MG Elite spoke in 2020, stating, "You're not there at MG Elite to have fun. You're here to work. If I wanted her to come home happy, I'd send her to clown school." This parent strictly neglected the daughter's happiness and treated the sport like a job. It was no longer supposed to be fun for the gymnast. She didn't have a future beyond gymnastics. In simple words, this was her future. This was her only future. Another parent from MG Elite, whose daughter was 4 years old, stated, "You're there to work. You're not there to have fun," describing this as a 9-to-5 job. How can these parents compare a sport to career when the children cannot legally work at this age? Children are in gymnastics to have fun and burn energy, not to be the breadwinners for their families. Parkett's parents in a 2022 Morning Call article stated that they felt they struggled to make the right decisions for their daughters that balanced their well-being with hopes for success in what they may consider the world's most difficult sport. One stated, "As a parent, you weigh in all of these options, and you try to make decisions that are the best interest for your daughter, and ultimately, you make mistakes. Parents struggle to understand that although they are trying to provide the best for their child, they must remind them that this is a temporary sport. This is not their life. There is more to life than just gymnastics. But some kids never learn this, and they are broken when they leave the sport. They turn to drugs, alcohol, and sometimes even suicide attempts. They don't know how to handle the pain. They don't know what else they are supposed to do with their free time. They struggle, and it's because the parents didn't prepare them for life outside of gymnastics. And the Olympic high doesn't last long, no matter how much it brings in at the moment." Wendy Bruce said that even after getting to the Olympics, that agents weren't interested in their bronze medal win. She struggled after retiring from the sport. In a 2020 interview with What Makes You Think, she said, "I went from having a pressure-filled, strict, daily and hourly schedule to an open day. I went from someone telling me what to do, how to do it, and when to do it, to no one telling me anything. I went from feeling emotions of fear to exhilaration and feelings of emptiness. From the time I was 5, I was trained to live my life with a purpose. And then, one day, I had no purpose. I was lost. I dated guys that caused drama. I partied a lot. I stayed out late. Found unhealthy ways for me to challenge myself and feel something. It wasn't until I met my husband Dennis and had our 2 daughters that I started to find a healthy purpose again. I love that I could challenge myself in new ways that were just as fulfilling as gymnastics. I went back to college to finish my degree. I fell in love with psychology and founded a mental training company." Wendy, among many other gymnasts, struggle when they retire. They need their parents to provide even more support when they leave the sport as when they entered. But parents assume that because of their work ethic, that they will be able to handle life as gymnastics because life in gymnastics will be harder than life after gymnastics. But this isn't true. Parents need to remember that anytime you quit something that means a lot to you, that you will have withdrawals. And if that's the only thing they know, then it will make it hard. A parent needs to remember to be a parent and a parent only, because in the end, it's not about the sport, it's about the child.